das Risiko auf Skitour.
There are countless aids and methods for dealing with risks on ski tours in the Alps. One fundamental and very widely used strategy is the 3x3 filter method. Here we take a look at three pillars: the conditions, the terrain, and the people, so who is on the tour. And then we have these three filters. So we plan the whole thing at home or in the cabin, make our preliminary plan. That's our first filter. The second filter is on site, in the mountains. So we go out, we observe, we get an impression, we look at what's going on around us. And the third filter, the third level, is the individual slope. I actually stand in front of my slope and ask, go or no go? And if it's go, what route do I take? The big advantage of this 3x3 filter method is that I can change my decisions. Things I might have missed or viewed differently in the planning stage are revised on site if possible, or at the latest when I reach the individual slope. If I see that I actually do have an avalanche problem here, contrary to my assumption during tour planning. And then I have the chance to say, okay, that makes no sense today, it's too dangerous, we'll do something different. The first filter in this 3x3 filter method is the planning stage. This means we haven't yet collected any information from the mountain. We don't have any observations. Instead, we rely on forecasts, such as the weather forecast or the avalanche bulletin, which is very important when it comes to the conditions. And this gives us the important information. Namely, not just A, how dangerous it is, that's a bit vague, but rather specific information, such as where the dangerous areas are and what my avalanche problems really are today. So can I expect a wind-drifted snow problem or a temperature problem? The information in the avalanche report forms the basis of whether my planned tour makes sense at all, or whether it would be better to plan an alternative destination or even go somewhere else entirely.
The second aspect of the conditions is the weather. Weather refers to the contributing factors that affect us as tours. What do we have? We have precipitation. Is it snowing? Is it raining? Is there any grapple? We have the wind factor. This refers predominantly to the strength and direction of the wind. You have to know that winds over 40 kilometers per hour cause wind-drifted snow, and not least because this means the wind is the architect of avalanches. Then we have temperature. When temperatures get really low, dangerous situations can often last longer than when the temperature is around zero. And for each of us personally, when we have to endure very low temperatures and there's a strong wind blowing as well, it can very quickly get uncomfortable. And one thing that is particularly important when it comes to weather conditions is visibility. A lack of visibility is a good reason to call off a tour. And if I already know in the planning stage that visibility is very poor, then I choose a destination that I can get to even in poor visibility. This means I might stay in the forest or in well-structured terrain.
When planning, the next thing I need to do after getting my information from the avalanche bulletin is to take a look at the terrain. So the question is, which terrain makes sense in these conditions regarding steepness, regarding slope aspect, regarding how demanding it is overall? And to help you get both of these components right, there are aids such as the 30-degree method tool for identifying cruxes in these conditions, or the Is the Tour Okay tool for determining whether the risk is consistent in these conditions regarding the steepness, the demands of the tour, or whether the tour is rather a bit foolhardy or risky. When planning the terrain, information taken from topographic maps is of course very important. So the things that interest me most are steepness, then of course the slope aspect, am I in or near the dangerous areas indicated in the avalanche bulletin, but also questions concerning terrain traps, so concerning consequences. So is there a forest on the slope below me that an avalanche could force me into, or even a gorge that I could be dragged into? These are all things I need to focus on and can find in a topographic map when considering the terrain factor.
When ski touring, it's a good idea to ensure you never travel alone. This means you travel in a group. And when several people are traveling together in the mountains, one is certainly going to be stronger, another will be a bit better at skiing, another will want to travel on slopes that are significantly steeper, or another will want to enjoy themselves a bit more. In the end, you must always consider what shape every group member is in regarding their physical condition, their ability, and their motivation. Physical condition is relatively easy to assess and needs to be good enough for you to get up the mountain and down again safely. Ability has different aspects. For one thing, your skiing ability is of course important and it has to be good enough for you to easily descend safely. For another, your walking technique must also be good enough for you to safely ascend, especially if the slope is steep. Another aspect of ability concerns emergency management. Each group member should or must be good enough at this for you to make it to the tour destination. The third is motivation. This means it is important to communicate within the group what you want to do today. And the worst thing is if the group is very uneven. That is to say that someone is out just to enjoy themselves and another is very athletic in their approach. And that can cause conflict from the very beginning. And that's something you should avoid. And you can avoid it through good tour planning. The plan must logically always be translated to the terrain and implemented in the mountains. This means when you are on the site, whether you are starting from a cabin or right there in the mountains, you must check if the parameters of your plan are reasonably accurate. And you look at all the aspects again, so the conditions, the tour destination, the terrain, and the group. Let's start with the conditions. For conditions, you look at whether the snow situation and the avalanche situation are more or less favorable than planned or exactly as planned. This means, is the amount of new snow exactly as high as forecast or perhaps lower? Is the wind stronger? Is there more wind-drifted snow? Is there less wind-drifted snow? Or is it perhaps wetter or drier or colder or warmer than expected? In other words, you check whether the conditions are accurate or not. The same goes for the weather. If the visibility is perhaps better, then you're in luck. You can be happy about that and make use of it. And if the visibility is poor, then you just have to hold back a bit. Use your alternative plan if necessary, replan, and go for a less demanding destination. In our experience, we very often see that the group factor is not given enough attention. This means that at the start, you should naturally ask whether everyone present is of the right personal disposition on the day of the tour. But then you must definitely go one step further. You should actually ask again whether you all have a full set of equipment. When it comes to equipment, there is one item that we focus on in particular, the avalanche transceiver. This means that on every ski tour, we always carry out an avalanche transceiver check at the starting point, a thorough one in which the transmit and search functions of every device are checked. But also the other things, for example, whether you have a pair of thick gloves for when it's very cold, whether you have a full set of emergency equipment, whether you have a first aid kit. It definitely makes sense to address this and once again, agree within the group on what you can expect on today's tour.
In the last zonal filter, I evaluate the individual slope. Here I will find out whether I have planned well and whether the observations I have made on site are accurate here too. For example, I ask myself specifically about warning signs. Have they been observed? Can I see any tracks on the slope? What is the situation regarding the avalanche problem? If there is one, how pronounced is it? Then, of course, the terrain. So, are there any terrain traps? Where would an avalanche drag you? But I also need to keep an eye on my group members. What mood are they in? How capable are they? What physical condition are they in?
The primary point of planning is to consider all of the relevant aspects you may encounter on the tour. And that's why it's so important when you're on the tour for you to try to verify all of the points in the plan and check whether it is accurate or if the situation is different. Here, danger signs or warning signs are particularly important. For example, if you see fresh avalanches, that's a perfect indication of a high level of avalanche danger. Settling sounds, crack formation, infiltration, extreme water infiltration. These are all signs that the risk of an avalanche is high. And ideally, I will have already addressed these aspects in my plan, or at least heard them before. If I haven't heard it, it is especially important when I'm out on tour that I always keep my eyes open and fully extend my senses so I can identify the situation on site. Is it more or less favorable than in my plan?
But on the individual slope, it is also important not only to evaluate the conditions and terrain factors, but also to keep an eye on the people factor. Specifically, how are my group members? Are they coping with the demands? For example, the steepness, the danger of falling. But also, how do we organize ourselves as a group regarding avalanche danger? Therefore, safety intervals, load-reducing intervals, where should our assembly points be? It's about these connections again, between people, the group, the people factor, the conditions and the terrain. A popular method for assessing risk is the DCMR method. This means I take a look at the danger, the hazard, the probability of a hazard, the consequences, look at what measures I can take, and the whole thing makes up the risk. This approach can be seamlessly integrated into the 3x3 method.
Basically, ski touring and free riding are actually very complex if you consider all of the factors and if you want to address every aspect. But because they are so complex, it really helps to use a structure when planning. For example, this 3x3 filter method, where you split everything into simple parts: conditions, terrain, people, and also observe them at different locations or apply something like a risk management strategy, such as the DCMR method. Then it is much easier to structure, then the aspects are relatively simple and can be answered in a targeted way. Questions that can be answered in a targeted manner. In this way, planning quickly becomes very logical and easy for anyone to do, just as easy for a beginner as for an experienced mountaineer.